My name is Dwayne Peters, and I'm with the Lupus Foundation of America National Office in Washington, D.C. And this is another in a series of updates that we have been providing on the coronavirus and its impact on people with lupus. Lupus is one of the three indications the FDA has granted for hydroxychloroquine, sometimes sold under the brand name of Plaquenil. And many people with lupus rely on this medication to manage their disease and to prevent flares. Reports have surfaced recently among our community that the medication is either unavailable or only provided in limited quantities. Now, the Lupus Foundation of America, in particular our government relations and advocacy team, have been working to address this issue and on behalf of our constituents trying to increase the supply or reserve the availability of this medication for people with lupus. Now, last week, we posted an update with Pat Wildman, who is the Vice President for Government Relations and Advocacy with the Lupus Foundation of America. And he provided an update on what the foundation has been doing to address this issue and to ensure that people with lupus have access to this medication. For this update, I've invited Travis Smith, who is the Director of Government Relations for the Lupus Foundation of America, to provide us with an update and to also talk about a new resource that's available for people with lupus here in the United States. Since our interview last week with Pat, the FDA has added hydroxychloroquine and chloroquine to their database of drug shortages. Why is this particular designation by the FDA critical and important to our community?
Yeah, it's really important. And, you know, in your interview with Pat and even at the top, you highlighted a number of different ways that we're working on this issue. And the FDA has been engaged with them really from the beginning, going back when we first started hearing about the issues with hydroxychloroquine and chloroquine. So to some people, it might sound like the FDA is acting a little late, only, you know, a little over a week ago, adding this to their shortage list. But they are constantly taking reports from pharmacists, from manufacturers of these medications. And they need to be able to confirm that there is an actual shortage that's affecting big parts of the country for them to add those drugs to this drug shortage list. So now that the drugs have been added, that means that the FDA is going to be engaged at the highest possible level to resolve this shortage as soon as possible. So that means working with us at the foundation. As I said, we've been in touch with them really from the beginning when we first started hearing those reports of these shortages and of issues with people with lupus getting access to the drugs they need. They're working with people on Capitol Hill, including our Congressional Lupus Caucus that we'll talk about in just a minute. But they're also working with manufacturers to make sure that the FDA and that everyone involved, all the stakeholders, are doing everything they possibly can to bring an end to this shortage. It's also important to note that, you know, we're going to talk about the new resource we have that is tracking the state actions in regards to hydroxychloroquine and chloroquine. And in a lot of ways, the states are looking to the FDA for guidance. And since FDA added these two drugs to their shortage list, we've seen a pretty substantial uptick in the amount of states that have taken action and done something, whatever that may be. We'll talk about the specifics in a minute. But they've done something to bring an end to the shortage. So it's really important and critical to our fight to get the access for these drugs to people with lupus that they are appearing on the FDA shortage. So this is something that is really important as we continue to fight for that.
You mentioned the Congressional Lupus Caucus, and I understand that they have been partnering with the Congressional Arthritis Caucus and have sent a letter to the White House and urging them to address this issue. Can you tell us a little bit more about that and some more specifics?
Yeah, absolutely. So to start, the Congressional Lupus Caucus is a group of lawmakers in the United States House of Representatives that come together informally. A caucus here in D.C. on Capitol Hill is a group of lawmakers that meet informally because they have a shared passion for an issue. So if you look up the list of caucuses, there's caucuses for just about every issue, recreational sports, things like that. For the Lupus Caucus, this is a group of more than 60 individuals, lawmakers in the House of Representatives, who come together because they have a interest in doing everything they can to fight lupus. So that might be a personal connection to the disease, that might be a constituent that they represent, has shared their journey with lupus to them. But whatever the reason, they come together in this caucus, in the Congressional Lupus Caucus, to make sure that on Capitol Hill they're doing everything they can to further our fight against this disease. They partnered with the Congressional Arthritis Caucus. The Lupus Caucus is co-chaired by Representatives Eddie Bernice Johnson from Texas, Representative Peter King from New York, and Representative Bill Keating from Massachusetts. The co-chairs of the Congressional Arthritis Caucus, Debbie Dingell from Michigan, and David McKinley from West Virginia, excuse me, they came together and they heard from what we were saying, they heard from what the Arthritis Foundation was saying, that this is an issue that needed to be addressed. And they got together to develop a Dear Colleague letter that they could circulate on Capitol Hill with some ways that the White House Coronavirus Task Force can address this issue. A Dear Colleague letter is something that goes around. Any member in the House of Representatives can sign onto it to show their support for whatever issue the letter is addressing, which obviously in this case is the shortage of hydroxychloroquine, chloroquine, and the issues people with lupus and rheumatoid arthritis are having in getting access to those medications. The letter closed this past Friday at COB, close of business, and we are really excited to say that it was signed by 50 representatives in the House of Representatives. That's a bipartisan group. It's going to send a really strong message to the White House Coronavirus Task Force and get them engaged as well and make sure that they're doing everything in their power to make sure that people with lupus and rheumatoid arthritis can get access to the drugs that they need.
Last week, Pat mentioned, and I think you may have touched on it as well, that the foundation had sent a letter to the state boards of pharmacies around the country and urging them to address this particular issue. I know that recently you, in particular, and the rest of your team have been working to develop a resource for people with lupus about what is happening in the states to address this crisis. Can you explain that resource and just provide our members and constituents a little bit more updated information about that resource?
Yeah, absolutely. This is something that was posted to our website at the end of the day on Friday, and it's something that we're really excited about because we know that people with lupus are going through a lot right now, and there's a lot of stress and there's a lot of anxiety, particularly as it relates to getting the medications that they need, hydroxychloroquine and chloroquine. So what this resource is doing is tracking everything that every state in the country has done in regard to this issue. And there's a number of different categories and ways that the states are acting, and we'll get into those in just a minute. But this resource is something that we think will be really helpful for people with lupus. One of the things that we're always telling people, even on a normal, under normal circumstances, when you're going to the pharmacy, there's a lot of layers that are taking place within that one transaction. So you have your prescription that you got from your doctor, you're giving that to the pharmacist, they're running it through their system, they're checking with your insurance to find out what the price is going to be and whether it's covered, whether they need back to the doctor and further authorize this. And then obviously there's the actual dispensing of that drug, making sure that the pharmacist has that drug in stock and can actually give you the quantity that you need. So one thing we're always telling people when there are issues at the pharmacy counter is to find out where that issue is coming from. With so many layers, it's really hard to address a particular issue, address not being able to get access to your drug if you don't know what is causing that issue. So is it because the prescription that your doctor wrote had something wrong with it, or the pharmacist can't read it even? Is it that your insurance is putting an additional check on this prescription, or that the pharmacist doesn't have the drug in supply? So those are under normal circumstances. And with everything that's going on in regard to COVID-19 at this point and hydroxychloroquine, those issues are even more, I think, exacerbated. So what we're hoping is that this resource will help people untangle what's going on when they go to the pharmacy counter. So if you go to the pharmacy counter in your state, you have a prescription for either drug like you normally do, and they're not able to dispense that to you, or they're only able to dispense it in a quantity that is not what the prescription was written for. If you usually get a 60-day fill and they're only able to give you 30 or 14, this resource is going to help you figure out exactly why that's happening. So has your state government done something to make that necessary? Has the State Board of Pharmacy issued guidance that is kind of dictating what the pharmacies can do and what the pharmacy chains can do? Or is there an issue with the pharmacy itself? Do they just not have enough in supply? And we think this resource will be really helpful. So at lupus.org/state-action, it's also been posted to our main COVID-19 webpage that we've been keeping updated throughout. You'll be able to go in and click on your state and find out exactly what it is they have done or have not done to address this issue. And from there, you can figure out, you know, if you are having issues getting access to these drugs, if your pharmacy is not able to dispense them to you, you can kind of start to untangle why that's happening. And then from there, get a solution. I think it's really important to view this resource as a kind of add-on to a resource that we had, I believe, at the beginning of last week, which was tips to refill or get fills for your hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine. There's a ton of really great guidance in there. There was things on checking with multiple pharmacies, starting the process earlier than you would normally, so that if there's delays, you don't have to go without your medication. And I think if you take those resources and the tips that were in that, and then kind of cross-reference them with what your state is doing, it'll become a lot easier to figure out where the problems are coming from, and then from there, develop a solution to get the drug. So I think the example I use is, you know, if I'm in Louisiana, for example, and I have a prescription from my doctor for a 60-day fill of hydroxychloroquine, I go to the pharmacist and they tell me they're only able to dispense 14 days worth to me. Obviously, that's a problem. I need to get that 60-day supply, so I need to figure out where the problem's coming from. And if I go to lupus.org/stateaction, click on the state I'm in, click on Louisiana, I'm going to see that there's nothing my state has done to make the pharmacist respond in that way. The State Board of Pharmacy in Louisiana has issued guidance and encouraged pharmacists to act in a certain way, but it's not an executive order. It's not an administrative order. So that pharmacist is not legally bound to act in that way. So in that instance, it might make sense for me to call other pharmacies that I can get to. That pharmacist is making a decision based on where they work or based on, you know, what their boss told them, but other pharmacies might be making different decisions. So I can go back and I can call other pharmacies and ultimately try and find someone that is able to distribute that 60-day fill. But if you contrast that with a state like New York, if I'm not able to get that 60-day fill and I go to this lupus.org/stateaction, what I'm going to see is that New York has an executive order on the books that is limiting and prohibiting any pharmacist in the state from dispensing more than a 14-day supply. So in that instance, it doesn't make sense for me to call other pharmacies because not one pharmacy or pharmacist in the state of New York is legally able to dispense more than a 14-day supply. So that's kind of the value in this resource, is untangling the different things that are going on and figuring out, you know, where the problem lies. And hopefully that makes it easier and easier to understand where these problems are coming from.
Well, that's very good information. And I think it's helpful to understand that each state will be different and thus the need for this particular resource. Can you help us understand some of the different things that the states are doing and or the policies that they're setting to address all of these issues?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, obviously with 50 states and Washington, D.C., it's difficult to kind of categorize these. All the states are acting in their own way, and there's a lot of nuance that goes into it. So it's hard to say, you know, this is what these number of states are doing, and this is what this number of states are doing. But, you know, there are kind of three rough categories to the actions that they're taking. The first one is that the states that haven't done anything, so their board of pharmacy or their governor, they haven't done anything, at least publicly, where we could access it to affect the dispensing or the prescribing of hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine. So there's a number of states, I believe it's 13 or 14 states, that just haven't said it. One of those states that is a little unique in that they've said something is Alabama. They said something, their board of pharmacy issued guidance saying that they weren't going to issue anything else on this issue. They said that they were hearing from both sides of the issue, and they were just not going to say anything. They were going to defer to the judgment of the prescribers and the judgment of the pharmacist, and that was going to be as far as they got involved. There are other states that have set guidance, but have not done anything that, going back to my last example, would legally bind the pharmacist or the prescribers. So they might, like Louisiana, the example I gave before, they might say that, you know, we think prescribers should not be writing prescriptions for the prevention of COVID-19, or if they're writing a prescription for the treatment of it, there needs to be a confirmed test or the person needs to be checked into a hospital. But the prescriber is ultimately able to use their own discretion and use their own judgment. The same thing goes for the pharmacist. They might say that, you know, you need to take note of your own supply of the drugs, and if it makes sense for you, consider only distributing a 14-day supply, even if the person has a 30-day supply. So there's a category of states that have acted, have commented, are aware of the issue, but are ultimately deferring to the judgment of their prescribers and the pharmacists that operate in the state. And then there's a third set that has done something that is legally binding how pharmacists or prescribers act. So the example I gave earlier was New York, where Governor Andrew Cuomo has said that, issued an executive order saying that pharmacists cannot legally dispense more than a 14-day supply of hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine, no matter what it's being used for, whether the prescription is for the treatment or prevention of COVID-19 or one of the FDA-approved indications, lupus, malaria, rheumatoid arthritis, the pharmacist can't do it. Nevada has acted similarly. So those are kind of the three buckets that you can put these groups into. But within those categories, there's a lot of action. Obviously, the states that haven't said anything. But within the states that have issued guidance, there's a lot of nuance to it. And with the states that have issued administrative orders or executive orders, there's also a ton of nuance. So they might be limiting the quantity that can be dispensed, as I mentioned, New York is doing. They might be explicitly prohibiting the prescribing of either drug or the dispensing of either drug for the prevention of COVID-19, but allowing it for the treatment of COVID-19 under narrow circumstances. Maybe, like I said, there has to be a confirmed test or the person has to be checked into a hospital to treat COVID-19. But there's a lot of nuance to it. And that just, I think, gets to the importance of this resource. And we've done the work. We've went through, you know, all 50 states and DC's guidance. We've looked at the administrative orders and the executive orders, and we put that in one place for you. So you can go in, you can check your state, you can check the site for your state and find out what they've done to address this issue. And again, going back to that other resource with the tips for getting your prescriptions filled, I think when you put those two resources together, you're going to be in a much better shape to address this issue and to find out where the problem is coming from.
That's very good information. How should people be using this resource? What specifically should they do? Are there any specific procedures or advice on how to maximize the benefit?
Yeah, the first thing I would say is that, you know, whenever we talk about this, everything is changing very rapidly from day to day, even from hour to hour. So the first thing I would say is to check back often as you need it, because we're making updates every day. We're staying on top of it every morning and every night. We're making sure that if the state has done anything that day, we're trying to get it up to the website in real time as soon as we can. So that would be the first thing, would be to check back often. If, you know, each time you need a prescription filled, just head back there and see, you know, if your state has changed anything, if the guidance has changed, or if there's a new executive order, because we're going to keep this as up to date as we possibly can. But beyond that, it's really just kind of going back to that example I used with Louisiana and New York, is just making sure that you know where the problem is coming from. Is this pharmacy not able to give me my 60-day supply because they don't have enough of it, or because the governor has done something, or because they're operating under the guidance of the State Board of Pharmacy? And that's really the first step in addressing this problem. So then, you know, if I know this pharmacy can't give it to me, not because of anything the state has done, but because they just don't have the supply, now I can call other pharmacies. Now I can look around and ultimately try and find a pharmacy that is able to give that to me. And on the flip side, if I know that the state has limited how much they can give out, it's going to make more sense for me to just take the 14-day supply from that pharmacy, because no one else is going to be able to dispense any more than that to me. So I think that's where the value comes in, is being able to go to one place, look at your state, not having to sift through, you know, the Department of Health website or the Board of Pharmacy website, just being able to go to our website, lupus.org/state-action, and find out exactly what it is your state has done. You can read the full guidance, you can read the full letter, whatever it is, if you have an interest in that, or you can just get a quick summary of what they've done. And especially important is what it means for people with lupus.
Finally, I want to ask you, as you look at all of these state policies, is there anything that people with lupus should definitely be doing regardless of which state they live in?
Yeah, absolutely. So like I said earlier, you know, there's 50 states in DC, they're all acting differently. It's hard to get really general and give one universal tip that people with lupus can use. But the one thing that we are seeing in a number of states, to the point where I think it is worth everyone kind of taking it to heart and making sure they're doing everything they can, is making sure that when you're getting a new prescription for hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine, you're asking your prescriber to note what your diagnosis is on the prescription itself. A lot of states have set restrictions on, like I said earlier, whether the drugs can be dispensed for the treatment of COVID-19 or the prevention of COVID-19. Or, you know, some states have what we call look back periods, where they might issue an executive order, but it only applies to prescriptions that were written after the date that the executive order became effective. So if you were already established on the medication, whichever one it is, you're not going to be bound by that quantity limit or the lack of refills, whatever it might be. So it's really important that anytime you're getting a new prescription, just to be safe, no matter what your state has done, just have your prescriber write that diagnosis. It's what's called an ICD code. Just have them write it right there on the prescription, so that when you hand it off to the pharmacist, they look at it, they know that this is not for COVID-19, this is for the treatment of lupus, which is an FDA-approved indication, and that's going to put you in a much better position. A lot of states are allowing the pharmacist to call and verify with the physician in the absence of that written notice on there. But again, we're trying to get you in and out of the pharmacy as quickly as possible, so it's just easier from the start if you're in touch with your doctor, if you need to call them. And, you know, we know telehealth is becoming really popular right now, and getting a new prescription written, just ask them to note your diagnosis on there. It's just out of an abundance of caution, whether your state has acted in this way or not, it just makes it a lot easier and prevents those delays at the pharmacy.
Very good advice, Travis. I want to thank you very much for providing all of this really valuable information, and to congratulate you and your team, and thank you very much for the diligent efforts that you have been putting in. It's helpful for our community to hear what is being done, and to knowing that you and the foundation are working on this very important issue. If you'd like to be part of the Lupus Foundation of America's national advocacy effort and their network of advocates from across the country, you can sign up to become an advocate at lupus.org/advocate. You'll receive periodic updates on public policy, as well as action alerts when you taking action or sharing your story can really help get us across the finish line for legislation or changes in public policy. I'd like to thank Travis again. Thank you very much for taking time to be with us today. And we will be back again as soon as possible with an additional update. Thank you very much.